sent the message that peace and war are both options, and neither one is a given.
There was a sense that these were the militants, these were the extremists, these were the people who were against the peace process.
The IRA repeatedly felt that the only way they could get the British to listen to them is violence.
You must stand firm against terror. You must say to those who still would use violence for political objectives, you are the past. Your day is over.
The Docklands bomb pointed into the heart of darkness of the IRA in South Omar.
It was a moment of truth.
The calculation of the IRA was that a bomb in London was worth 10 bombs in Belfast. And a bomb in a sensitive area was worth a lot more than one in the middle of nowhere.
Exchange and Bishopsgate, which were on a huge scale, and with effectively the city under attack. This wasn't just a small car bomb going off somewhere like that. This was causing really very major damage, actually destroying buildings, which is something London wasn't used to at all.
They wanted to demonstrate that they were a force to be reckoned with, and that it was a way of putting pressure on John Major and on the British government.
So where are you going to be safe? That was the real concern. The Docklands era was just really a place, a part of London everyone had forgotten about. So the development that went into it was really very exciting.
But the tide was running against the men of violence at that stage.
We are demanding of Mr. Major's government that he takes decisive steps now to move the situation forward in a fundamental way, and that means fundamental political and constitutional change.
Clearly, we wanted something that was more than just a temporary ceasefire, because we made clear all along we did not wish to negotiate under the duress of a threat to return to violence.
The United States had always lined up with the British point of view, and no American president would have dared to interfere or be seen in Belfast or Northern Ireland before this. And yet here was Clinton breaking a 225-year tradition and landing in Belfast on Air Force One. So it was one of the most historic moments I've ever witnessed.
Clinton coming when he did, these were moves where the Americans were trying to help us to consolidate a process that was clearly coming under strain.
The Clinton visit actually produced a fair degree of euphoria. There was a degree of scepticism amongst unionists, but particularly the speech he made and the points which he covered then had a really big impact.
You must stand firm against terror. You must say to those who still would use violence for political objectives, you are the past. Your day is over. Violence has no place at the table of democracy.
The Irish government, the British government, the IRA were all locked in stasis at that point, and you were looking for some outside force, which was what America was always going to provide. I felt, arriving in Belfast, that, yeah, there were problems, but there were not sufficient enough to break the ceasefire.
Let us join our prayers in this season of peace for a future of peace in this good land. Thank you very much.
But little did we know, little did he know, that the ceasefire was over and that the IRA were planning the Docklands bomb.
The IRA so-called England department, the part of the IRA that planned and executed bombings in Britain, that was run out of South Armagh. It was the IRA's heartland, an area where they could operate with sort of relative impunity. The reputed chief of staff of the IRA lives in South Armagh on the border. You've also got IRA snipers here, and sniper at work signs on the lamppost.
Sniper team in South Armagh was pretty high profile and certainly been very effective from the Provisional IRA.
The shooting happened just after 1:30 on the outskirts of Cross Maglen. The soldier was a member of a foot patrol when a gunman opened fire. Locals reported hearing one shot. The soldier was hit in the chest and died a short time later.
They were shot from the car, a mile away perhaps. Soldier, police officer was killed. Car left the scene. They had built up a reputation. You know, signs on the streets, watch out, the snipers about. It was definitely mentally very draining. We knew the terrorists, we knew them well, actually. We knew very much who was doing what. I mean, yeah, they were pretty hard to catch.
We were consistently hearing the same thing, that the unionists really didn't trust this process and they needed the decommissioning in order to have their own politics moving forward. And the nationalists were really in need of some more from the peace process to show progress for this end of this violence. I'd personally never supported the violence. I thought it made it harder. Others in the IRA felt that it was the only way to get the British to talk to you.
Almost anybody concerned with the health of the peace process was very worried about the lack of progress towards the comprehensive negotiations that had been promised. And then Sir Patrick Mayhew put decommissioning on the table as a new precondition for political talks.
We can't, and therefore we won't, fudge the issue of arms and explosives. We don't ask for everything all at once. That would not be realistic. But if Sinn Féin and the other parties associated with the paramilitaries have truly given up justifying violence, then there is no longer any need for paramilitary weapons, is there?
Can we say that speech by Patrick Mayhew set in train the events that led us ultimately to Docklands?
I think any analyst who comes to write the history with the benefit of records and so on in the future will, I think, give it a significant place. In my view, that was probably the single most serious mistake made by any of the governments involved in the peace process.
The IRA guns are silenced, that we have this unprecedented opportunity for peace, and that we must build upon it and move the entire situation on. And that includes, of course, the decommissioning of all the weapons.
Are you, Peter? I'm glad that we're sharing a moment of history.
Certainly I, and I think others, didn't anticipate just what a difficulty decommissioning was going to turn out to be. I mean, I think we counted every month in 1995, where there hadn't been any killings, was a bonus. But later that summer, there was a preoccupation with the problems over the marches and Drumcree. What I remember the concern being in the centre of government in number 10 was doing what we could, grasping at the positive initiatives that would help to keep the process going.
We had to try to figure out a way to create a process that would permit the entry of the paramilitary groups to negotiations, but at the same time allow the constitutional parties to stay in on both sides. The mechanism that the British government had chosen prior decommissioning of weapons simply wasn't feasible. None of the paramilitaries would agree to it. And even some of those who advocated it publicly said to us privately, we know it won't work. You guys have got to figure out a way around this.
When the president decided to go to Northern Ireland in the fall, it was really frustrating because there was just no movement on the peace process. Decommissioning had become an issue way out of proportion in the nationalist community's view. And we knew that Adams was trying to avoid a split in the IRA, that the entire IRA was not on board.
Do you remember through that period in 1995 hearing any concerns about a split within the Republican movement if the British government and the Unionists stuck to this demand that decommissioning would have to happen first?
Yes, I do remember talk of that. But, and I remember there were some intelligence reports about that.
They'd given them a little running room to see, but if it didn't deliver on the agenda for the nationalist community, they would pull the plug out from him. We knew he was walking quite a tightrope.
This was huge symbolism, and that was the moment that seemed to crown the trip. But then Jerry came over after the handshake and came with us and said, come with me, and we went down the street.
We were asked to go to a particular house in West Belfast, and we arrived really not expecting what happened.
Neil O'Dowd and I met with Jerry Adams, just himself, and he told us that if the peace process didn't bear fruit quickly, the ceasefire was not going to last.
It was a very dire message, which was given to us in no uncertain terms.
Jerry said, when are they going to stop kicking the dog? The dog is sleeping, being the IRA. It's not engaged in actions. Whether it has arms or not is really not the key. It's a question of whether it uses arms. That, and the more they kick the dog, the more the dog is going to wake up and go back to its old habits.
In this tiny Belfast, housing estate, we were told very much that, no, things were very bad, that we could expect something very bad unless something improved.
You were being told by Jerry Adams, effectively, that the ceasefire was over, and that this was the fault of the British government.
Well, I don't know that we were told that it was over, per se. We were told that it would be over unless, and the unlesses were talks and a deferral of the decommissioning issue.
For people to do their holiday shopping without worry of searches or bombs, to visit loved ones on the other side of the border without the burden of checkpoints or roadblocks, to enjoy these magnificent Christmas lights without any fear of violence. Peace has brought real change to your lives.
We definitely felt leaving that house, it was on the brink. Then we went to the town hall in Belfast where I was thinking, my God, this might be the worst ever moment of the whole thing, where it should be the happiest moment. So it was a pretty stiff, cold bucket of water thrown over my high expectations.
10!
President Clinton was here speaking in the front of City Hall and telling terrorists that their day was over. South of Man was already preparing to bomb London.
Yes. I've said it then, I said now.
That's a fact.
Yeah.
They would have had to be doing that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you just wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to bomb London, let's get it, and load it up that night. The workforce, the active people that come in and load the heavy duty stuff into the lorry, to them it's a job. You know, they'll not know the target. They'll not know where it's going. They'll know it's a bomb because that's what they're packing. And, weeks, months later, it happens.
Thank you.
South Armagh IRA has always been very much based around families, interconnected by marriage. But, you know, you're talking about six or eight families of, you know, brothers and sons, and sometimes grandsons, sometimes working together on the same operation. This is where trust was sort of, you know, ran through people's blood. There was a sense that these were the militants, these were the extremists, these were the people who were against the peace process.
These were very dangerous people who had a number of other skills and tactics. The sort of skills you find in rural communities, you know, where you want to be mending your own farming equipment yourself, you want to be able to weld and put your tractor back together again, and where you find the tools about that you need, and you find odd pieces of angle iron and aluminium to build the truck that they did. It was an unusual looking vehicle, and the bomb was buried deep into the fabric of the vehicle and welded into place so that it could survive. As long as the terrorists kept their nerve, it could survive a cursory search. First time it comes over on the 15th of January, there's no bomb inside the vehicle. So the dummy run gave them the opportunity to test the various security systems, you might call them, or choke points at where they might be at greater risk on the way in. Looking for traffic officers on the route, all the things that might cause them risk. They've fitted it up with a tachograph and everything. It looks like what it is, which is a vehicle that's being used to transport second-hand vehicles to and from Ireland. Napoleon said, "Time spent on reconnaissance is rarely wasted."
We said in our report that we did not think prior decommissioning was feasible, but we suggested the possibility of parallel negotiation and decommissioning, that you begin the talks and you try to do both talk and decommissioning in parallel.
We approached it with a sense of urgency because we believe that is what the situation demands.
I think we were a little bit shocked in a way by the idea he came up with of parallel decommissioning.
While the decommissioning of arms may be segregated in theory, in the real life of Northern Ireland, it is interwoven with many other issues and with much history.
John Major chose to deal with it in a particular way by not focusing on that particular bit of his report, but by picking up the idea, which was sort of buried rather obscurely in the report, about elections.
We believe that in the light of the Mitchell report, there are two ways in which all party negotiations can now be taken forward. The first is for paramilitaries to make a start to decommissioning before all party negotiations. They can, if they will. If not, the second is to secure a democratic mandate for all party negotiations through elections specially for that purpose.
Would he now fix a debt for all party talks rather than the 17 months that he has wasted up till now? And could I... I live with it, you don't.
It was clear that despite the Clinton visit, despite the Mitchell initiative, that John Major just couldn't bring himself to do what needed to be done. I always saw John Major as the guy who, you know, if you start with the Downing Street Declaration, he knew there was a door, the door was open, he peeked through the door, but he could never go through the door. I think there wouldn't have been Canary Wharf if the British reaction to the Mitchell proposal had been, okay, talks start on March 1, and, you know, we'll follow this formula.
If the ceasefires were to break down, we might receive very little, if any, warning. And without doubt, many of the key targets would, as before, be on this side of the water.
I don't think we necessarily thought that, okay, this is going to be the straw that breaks the camel's back, you know, this is the last thing that's going to break the ceasefire. But in any case, we had to react in the way that we had to react, and everybody has to sort of take their positions in these things and then try and work it out from there. Yeah, although we didn't think it was going to help, I don't think we thought that this is necessarily the end of the peace process.
I don't know that I ever said, well, here comes the bomb. I don't think I would ever have allowed myself to do that. It was almost becoming complicit in the bomb.
They know exactly what they're doing and where they're going to go to. They absolutely replicate the dummy run. They stay the night in Carlisle in the truck stop. And then heading all the way towards London.
On the old agenda once again. The guns have been silenced for the last 18 months. I mean, would you prefer they weren't silenced?
Mr. Adams knows that those guns should never have been used in the first instance. To keep on saying they're now silent and give himself a pat on the back is a lot of codswallop. He knows that.
But River Road, I would think they're a bit nervous by that time. They would drive in from River Road in the East End of London. To put it right in the heart of the Docklands. They know that they have to put the vehicle down, tell whoever's in control that the vehicle is in place, and then the calls can go in. There's a big bomb in the Docklands. There's clearly two of them, and they park it, set the timer, get out and walk away.
Typical Friday evening, the 6 o'clock bulletin being put to bed,
And I've sat there at the news desk and a phone call came through. A Northern Ireland accent, a man said, from 6 o'clock that evening, the IRA ceasefire would end. Initially, there was a sense of disbelief.
A friend of mine came down and said, come on, let's go, have a glass of wine. And I started getting these messages, phone the commissioner urgently, and I hadn't even got the glass up to my lips, and they just kept coming.
I was in the White House in the West Wing and got a call from Jerry Adams that he'd been hearing things that, you know, basically warning us that he thought this was going to happen.
I had a call from Nancy Soderbergh because they'd also heard from Sinn Féin. I don't know exactly what the message was, but I think it was to the effect that from Jerry Adams that the ceasefire is going to break and it's not my fault. something like that.
We go over to Peter Sissons in the newsroom for a news report.
According to reports on the Irish state broadcaster RTE in Dublin, the IRA has broken off its ceasefire. The television and radio station received a call claiming to be from the IRA early this evening.
And frankly, my first reaction is, you know, RTE, I've got excited about this. This, you know, doesn't make sense. There's just no point. And from the point of view of the Republican movement, in having a ceasefire and then resorting to violence, it was only going to do damage to the Republican movement.
The commissioner said to me, the ceasefire's broken and we think there's a bomb in the Docklands. The IRA, they said, you've got an hour to clear the area, and they were desperately clearing it.
At 6 o'clock I came on duty. I reported to my control centre, placed on my uniform, and I went to work.
About half six to quarter to seven, Inam phoned up saying that we've been told to leave the premises. I could hear John Jeffries, one of our member of staff. I could hear him in the background laughing, joking. I think he was talking to PC McGrath. And Inam was saying, look, we're coming out, we're going, we're just going to make the premises safe and we're leaving.
I started to realise something might have gone wrong when I saw police vehicles in the road. But we had no warning whatsoever there was a bomb in Marsh Wall. We had no warning whatsoever.
Saw this whoosh of light, like a long, flat flash across the horizon.
Stop.
You could see, looking right across London, it was a big bomb had gone off.
Well, initially I thought, where's that light? I thought, well, that's, where's that come from? And then actually, I was blown into the air, and I woke up with all rubble on top of me. I couldn't hear initially very well. I dug my way out of the wreckage, and I remember thinking, I knew I was alive. I knew I was alive at that time, but I remember thinking to myself, where has everything gone? And then I could see people on the road, some of the horrific injuries, appalling injuries.
About 7:10, one of my sellers that work at Fleet Street with us said, look, a bomb's gone off around Docklands. Have you heard anything? So I said, no, let me call the shop quickly, because they haven't reported in. So I called numerous times. Then we went straight to the scene. and it was all cordoned off. We were told by a police officer that, look, all the injured people have been moved to different hospitals.
Hundreds of people are injured by flying glass. A scene of utter devastation, you know, like anything you've ever seen in a movie. And, you know, that sort of flickering light from the fire brigade and torches and all that, it's like a scene from the apocalypse.
Shortly before 6 o'clock this evening...
Can you speak up, please?
Shortly before 6 o'clock this evening, there were a series of warnings coded of a recognised nature that brought the police and the emergency services here. Whilst they were clearing the scene, an explosion occurred at 7 o'clock. There have been a number of casualties. It's too early to say the precise nature of those casualties. The Metropolitan Police has never dismantled its ability to respond quickly to this kind of incident. Thank you.
Irish violence returned to the streets of Britain tonight, cruelly, unexpectedly, and with a deafening retort. Even at lunchtime today, Sinn Féin leaders were talking about the ceasefire holding. Tonight, they were nowhere to be seen.
Yes, we are.
I am.
Okay. Jarabs, did you know this was going to happen?
No, of course not.
Why did you not know? I mean, you've had this whole run-up to the ceasefire where you were advising the IRA, you persuaded them that the best option was to go with the nationalist consensus. You've, at the times, attempted to preserve that ceasefire since. It seems outrageous and strange that they would take a decision like this without consulting either you or some of your senior colleagues.
Well, none of the senior Sinn Féin people, and presumably none of the Sinn Féin people, were consulted. And, you know, it's no surprise. The IRA would not consult Sinn Féin about military operations.
You know, and you look at it and think, where do you start with this scale of devastation? How do you even begin?
Sinn Féin must decide whether they are a front for the IRA or a democratic political party committed to the ballot and not to the bullet.
The people of Great Britain do not deserve to have this violence wreaked upon them. We will not stop in our efforts until peace has been secured.
You know, do you look back now and see it as an intelligence failure?
Well, it was an intelligence failure in the sense that whenever anything like that happens and you don't know and you can't prevent it, it is, in that sense, an intelligence failure. But there have been a lot of intelligence failures over the years.
I think it was suggested that this had come from South Armagh. Within the first few days, 48 hours, I would have thought the finger was pointing towards the engineers in South Armagh.
Did you immediately think that South Armagh IRA were responsible for this?
The only ones that could have been South Armagh, and I was right.
You knew straight away that...
Instinctively knew. Didn't know through anybody telling me, just instinctively knew that has to be South Armagh.
We know this vehicle has been in the border area for a considerable time between November of 95 and January of 96.
Did you see it parked outside somebody's house in the last few weeks? Have you seen somebody working on it? Perhaps you work in the motor trade, perhaps in the conversion industry. Have you seen somebody working on this vehicle? We make the appeal and show the picture of the truck. Call number several hundred comes in from somebody who clearly knows what he's talking about, who says, I'm telling you, that truck was here at River Road Barking on this piece of waste ground. Exhibits officers go out there, talk to him, look at what they've got, instantly recognise that they've got something very useful here, and said, we've got to fingertip search this and see what we've got here. That gives us the Truck and Driver magazine. We find the tachographs. Anything else inflammable inside the tyre, I think they would probably have wanted to burn it. That was their MO, get rid of anything. So I think it was probably taken out of the vehicle to be burnt so it would disappear. I think they were spooked at that point. There's some suggestion that there was engineers working nearby, or maybe even the people who gave us the information showed too much interest in them and they didn't get to burn it. That gives us a thumbprint on that magazine, so you've got a start. We eventually track back to where that was bought, and you start matching the tachograph with the CCTV from the motorway. So you get to track the bomb vehicle backwards, if you like, up to Carlisle. That gets us to room 107 in the truck stop. It's lucky that the cleaner hadn't polished the ashtray, because there is his thumbprint on that. They get to Stranraer, get the ticket back from the ferry, and there is his thumbprint on the Stena ticket. The initial three thumbprints, which tell us that we can link the three sites, are one on the trucking magazine, two on the ashtray in the truck stop at Carlisle, and three on the ticket for the ferry that brings it over. So cool, here we got three thumbprints.
We went through all our records and there was nothing coming up, which was quite unusual because, you know, 9 times out of 10 we would have had suspects in custody at some point through the Troubles, and we would have been fingerprinted. So for us not to get a hit, if you like, on that was quite significant.
Evidence from the bits of the truck that looked as though they'd been cut from something else. So you were looking for, it might just be an inch chopped off to make it fit, or filings, you know, that it was that sort of stuff we were looking for. We also knew that the truck had been painted a different colour, so there would be paint splashes that you can perhaps match. Now, none of those things wouldn't prove an individual was attached to it, but it might give us that was where the truck had been made or adapted. Then together, that would begin to give you a picture.
that operation in personnel, planning, finance, was probably the largest I've ever witnessed. If successful, it had the opportunity of literally taking out a team in South Armagh.
Were you sceptical about its ambitions?
Not sceptical, however. The longer you leave evidence, the less opportunity you have of getting it. And that could be for a whole lot of reasons, you know, weather, contamination. So from an investigator, as I would have been, I would have probably put the chances quite low in getting what they were setting out to get.
Morning of Trooping the Colour when we suddenly heard those news, which was very grim.
A huge lorry bomb devastated Manchester's city centre, injuring 200 people, the first time the IRA had struck since the Docklands bomb in February.
From a criminal investigation point of view, we were struggling, to put it mildly. We needed solid, solid evidence. So we were not getting that, and we were aware we weren't getting it. And from my point of view and my team's point of view, the morale was low because we weren't achieving, because it would have been our team that would have put them away. So we were starting to feel that weight on our shoulders.
Lance Bombardier Stephen Restoric was shot as he chatted to a motorist at this.
A soldier died after being hit by a single bullet while manning a vehicle checkpoint.
When that happened, we were full on in terms of we knew that, you know, this was it. Waited for an opportunity, and the opportunity, if it had presented itself, they would have shot a soldier dead. The opportunity didn't present itself. On the way back, the wheel literally came off their vehicle, and I think you could see quite clearly that the axle had gone into this farm. You could see the mark, the arc. Trailer anywhere. We came back the next day, and there was a reception committee waiting for them, and they were detained by the British Army.
The police have confirmed that two rifles have been recovered. One was a Barrett .50 with a telescopic sight, and the other an AK-47 assault rifle. A number of arrests have been made, although the police have not confirmed how many.
There was a Brian Adams rock concert, and I got a phone call. Okay, we've arrested the sniper team, and I said, "Cool, congratulations, that's wonderful. We've got the car, we got the rifle, we've got them all alive." Which was really good, and he said, and the fingerprint officers had a look at the first set of fingerprints they've taken from the people they've arrested. He said, and it is your, he just took one look at it, and he said, this is the triple thumbprint man. Once they've got his complete set, they identify that McArdle was up to his neck in the Docklands.
Not only was he caught for being in the car with the rifle, but also he was the suspect in the Canary Wharf bomb. And that was, in the policing world, that was just like, you know, it was like winning the lottery.
This was a very clean arrest operation. It's a very fragile political process, and I'm sure that that filtered down, you know, right down to the SAS. And I think that if there had been half a dozen IRA martyrs created that day, then the process could have taken a very different turn. It's fascinating that Byrne McGinn was even part of the team, because he was from County Monaghan, so he wasn't a South Armagh man. There's this sort of sense that they were betrayed by somebody who wasn't one of them. And, you know, there would still be questions, I think, about why you allowed an outsider being someone not from South Armagh, into that operation. And once he started talking, I mean, it all came tumbling out. He gave names of the IRA volunteers. He talked about Michael Carraher being the sniper on the Lance Bombardier Restoric operation when Byrne McGinn had ridden shotgun in the passenger seat with an AK-47, and that Michael Carraher had actually taken the shot. He gave the names of the people who mixed the Docklands bomb. And so it was the kind of information that the British authorities very, very rarely got about South Armagh, and it was a real break, not just in the sniper investigation, but in the Docklands investigation.
Probably right round and then up Marsh Road, so it's on the right there on this side of the road to park. Bits of the bomb truck finished up in the dock, and bits finished up half a mile down there. It was very, very good teamwork, and it includes the Royal Ulster Constabulary, it includes MI5 and the intelligence people, it includes the British Army, not to mention elements of the Royal Navy and the Royal Air Force. You know, this was the United Kingdom Anti-Terrorism PLC.
Those negotiations will start on the 10th of June. We're determined not to allow terrorism to interfere with the democratic process. There can be no ministerial talks with Sinn Féin, and nor can Sinn Féin take part in negotiations without a restoration of the ceasefire.
The great irony to me is Canary Wharf got the Republicans to the table. The British are so much, the words are here and the actions are there. And the actions of the British are, yes, you can bomb your way to the conference table. That's really what Canary Wharf was. It was the moment of truth. It was the moment that sent the message that peace and war are both options, and neither one is a given.